Joy, and welcome to my studio. Today we're working on the corn husk harvest basket, and this is made from one of our Dollar Tree or Dollar Store pumpkins. And we're going to start by dyeing our corn husk, and after that we'll show you how to start from there. We're going to start with our corn husk, and one of the biggest questions I get asked is where to find them. You can usually find them in the ethnic section, and if you look, they're like in the Mexican food section, as well as we've also found them in the produce section. I've also found them sometimes at Dollar Tree and at the 99 cent store. The cheaper, the better. They work. We don't want a lot of preservatives, especially wax, so the cheaper they are, the better they work. In one package goes a long, long ways. And the first thing I do is I take these, and you can see there is tons in here. They're really compressed tight. And I go and soak these in warm water in the sink and pull them out one by one. That's really, really important, because if you just put it like this into the dye, they're not going to dye all the way through. So it's really important to pull them out one by one. So while those are soaking, we're going to go ahead and start our dye. And I like to use the RIT liquid dye. It works so much better. You can find it at the craft stores as well as Walmart. And in Walmart, it's in with the, kind of think about where it's at, kind of where the bleach and everything like that would be, those kind of items, kind of in that section. It's not with the craft area, so think about it being there. And you want to, first thing you want to do is shake it very well. And on this, it has different things that you can add. And it's got, like, for nylon, add a cup of vinegar or different things. And also one of the ingredients is salt. So I add between a half a cup to a cup of salt. And then it says up to a gallon of water. And I usually don't add a gallon of water depending on how many I'm working on. This will actually do two of these really well. So I only put in a half one for one of these. You don't want to put the whole thing in, because it's going to absorb all to this. And when you go to do the second batch, there's going to be nothing left because it absorbs in. So it's real important that you only use half if you're doing a bag full of the tamale or the corn husk, what we make tamales out of. And then re-add the second half in here. So go ahead, get some water in here, and I only do enough water to cover my corn husk nicely. I don't put too much water in, because the more water you have, the less absorbent it's going to be. So I'd rather have it more potent. And then put it on, start to bring it to a boil, and also add your salt and then your color. Stir it up really, really well, and then go ahead and add your corn husk. And then if you need to add a little bit of more water, you can, and then stir it up. Another thing I used to do was stick it in and then put something on top of it to keep it push down so that the dye could get on top. And it doesn't go as well because you're not allowing it to get in between each one of them. So I don't do that anymore. I actually kind of take my tongs and move it around as it's going. Once it comes to a boil, just put it on a nice simmer, and you're going to simmer it for as long as you want the color to take. I probably did an hour to 2 hours, like on black, because you want the black really, really dark. It would probably almost take a couple of hours on that. And don't be afraid to add a little bit more color on in if you're not getting that. Now, by bringing it to a boil and getting it nice and hot, you're getting rid of the wax on the corn husk, if there is any. And sometimes it can be kind of a natural wax too. Don't think about an additive. And it makes it absorb better instead of doing it cold. So that is the reasoning behind it. So just keep it going until it gets the color you want. Remember, it's darker when it's wet. So when it dries, it's going to be lighter. And then what I do is if I'm going to do a second batch, and I usually just go ahead and do all my batches at once, so I have this set aside, and if I use it next time, that's fine. It's just a pain to do it again and again, so just get it all done at one time, and even if you wait for next year, that's okay. And then I take my tongs, I'm at the sink, and then I put it right into the sink and wash it off in cold water, so you're kind of setting it. And then I have what's left in here, and then I add my second half of the bottle so I don't have to start all over. I can reuse that, but remember, if you don't add this, it's going to be a way lighter color. And if you want that too, that's fine. That's all right. But if you want it to be consistent in color, you need to re-add that again and then keep on going. Now, once these are dry, I made a mistake with these and I've got to go back and do it. While they're still nice and warm, lay them out flat like the black and just lay them down on one top of each other and go put them in the sun or somewhere where they can dry. If you leave them, they can stay wet for several days. And on some of the projects, I don't mind, especially like this guy, if he's a little bit damp, that's okay. And that's why I had kind of left these, as I was kind of doing that and kind of bending him. So him being damp was a good thing. And that's the reason I didn't do that. But they can stay damp for days if they're stacked on top of each other, especially if the weather's not real warm. So if you want them to dry out, then go ahead and set them one on top of each other and get those dried. On the ones like these two here, we want them flat and wide. And so that's why we're going to go ahead and do that. And like I said, on the other pumpkin, if you're working on him, you may want them just a little bit damper so that you can bend those nice and tight. But that is how we dye our corn husk. Now that you've dyed your corn husk and you're getting those dry, we're going to go ahead and carve our pumpkin and start coloring that. Now these are the Miriam Joy craft templates, the circles, and if you don't have a set of these, you definitely need a set of these. They'll make your crafting so much easier. You can purchase those at miriamjoy.com. On the large set of circles, I pulled the fourth one from the middle, 1, 2, 3, 4, and because it's just big enough, we want it big enough to kind of go around the pumpkin, but not take up too much of it. So we're going to trace our circle, and I'm just holding it on. It is made of rubber, and it doesn't slip easy. Just make sure you've got that nice and centered. Wasn't that fast with our templates? And I'm going to just use a serrated kitchen knife to carve this out. Make sure you're not looking at your stem to center your circle, because those are not usually in the center. And I'm just going to insert that as up and down as I can get it. And I'm going to follow the circle all the way around. Take your time, don't rush it. Try to get that cut nice and even. And squeaky. If you have a pumpkin carving knife, that might work too. I just use a regular kitchen knife. And you want to make sure you line pretty much right where you started. So there we go. We've got that all in there. If you need to trim it off, go ahead and trim it off. I'm not going to set it back on, but I am going to paint the inside at this time. And this piece I kept and decorated. I really like that. And I may take a pin or some hot glue and stick that on to stay up on the side, or just display it close to it. I really like the lid with it. I think that is an added bonus on it. Now you're going to notice that the thickness in your pumpkin varies, and that's okay. And sometimes what I'll do is I have, now this one's not too bad, but sometimes I'll take my canned air and just blow it to get all the styrofoam off of it. And we're going to go ahead and paint the inside of it with a dark brown. It can be medium brown, dark brown, whatever you want to use, but it needs to be a multi-surface paint. And I'm using Folk Art Multi-Surface. And on this one, I'm going to use Real Brown, which is a very dark brown. On the other one, I didn't go quite that dark. I'm going to see if this one covers up just a little bit more. I'm going to wet my brush just to absorb the paint. And then I'm going to go ahead and just paint the inside. Don't spray paint this. This is foam and it doesn't have any covering over it, so it will melt on you. So I'm going to go ahead and cover that. And then I'm going to come up the sides of the edges. And I'm going to go ahead and do, now you can do a couple things. On this one I did just one piece of corn husk or two piece to cover that. Or you could paint that bottom. Either one is fine. And if you have a spot like that, you may just want to use the corn husk. And I'm going to go ahead, since I don't have any color on it at all, I'm going to go ahead and paint the bottom as well. Now, I am going to be using orange corn husk, but if you wanted to do brown, red, purple, whatever color you wanted to do, if it was a different color from what your pumpkin is, then go ahead and color or base coat your pumpkin with the multi-surface paint at this time. Now, this is probably going to take me at least two coats. The sides absorb more, so they'll probably only need one. And I'm not going to worry about being perfect because so much of this is going to get covered. If I get a little bit on something, I'm not going to worry about it at all. But the middle part and this part of the pumpkin will probably need two nice coats. So I'm going to go ahead and get those base coated and get those drying, and we'll come back and start putting on our corn husk. Okay, now that our inside and our paint is all dry on the lid and on the inside, I'm going to take my pencil and I'm just going to lay it down and I'm going to turn my pumpkin around all the way so we kind of know where we need to put our corn husk. So we've got to cover up all of that. And if you can do it in one corn husk, that's great. If you need to do it in two pieces, do it in two pieces. So what we're going to do is we're going to bring that all the way around with our hot glue. It's on high setting, so it has more work time in it. It doesn't dry too fast. And we're going to place that right over that hot glue. And that is covering our bottom. We don't want to bring the corn husk past the circle that we're going to make because it will actually not let your pumpkin sit up straight if you do. So we don't want to do that. My first one is always a learning experience. There's hours and hours and hours that go into these projects sometimes. So I'm going to cut this. Remove all the extra. Sometimes I even do two or three. So I did a second one. There's still things we're going to change on it on this third one. So, okay. So we've got that pretty much all the way around. You can glue some of these edges in that are out a little bit. But I can still see kind of the lines on my pumpkin, so I know where to come up to. And we're going to start with our corn husk. Now, your corn husks need to be dry at this time. You want to make sure that they're dry. This is not one of the projects you want to do with the damp corn husk. We do want to make sure that they're dry. And I'm going to tear them into probably about an inch and a half sections, and I'm going to be bringing them up and down depending on what I want, how far I want to bring them up. Now on this little guy, I came over the edges And I didn't like that either. If you were just going to do a plain edge and you brought it over the edge, it's okay. But I think it would look better just to see the dark brown paint inside instead of trying to get that all nice and even. And we're going to show you how to cover it up with pine cone petals, or I'm going to be actually using some acorns, I think, this time. So I'm going to go ahead and put my hot glue on, and it is hot, right up next to that part. And then I usually try to do this upside down so you can see it, then put my hot glue kind of up both sides, if I can kind of get them up both sides. And I'm going to stop right at our little part right there. Try and get these sides tucked in as much as possible. And we're going to come back over this side so it doesn't matter quite as much. Decide which way you're going to work. Work one direction, whether it's clockwise or counterclockwise, and stick with that so that the pattern ends up kind of being all the same way. Now I'm going to bring this one up from the bottom because it's wider down there. This area here to fill in is wider. And you can work back and forth between that, trying to figure out if you have a section that's wider, then start at the bottom, or if it's wider up at the top, then do it at the top. And I'm going to try and keep those as even with that rim, and I think that looks much better. Just make sure these little tails are glued down. Don't miss that. Now you might want to go the opposite direction here. And you want to just overlap just a little bit. But the most important thing is, because it gets wider in the middle, to make sure you're overlapped in the middle. I'll bring this up just a tad and I'll cut that off. I want that flat on the top. And I was working with some black corn husk. You could do these for Halloween. And I noticed that one side dies different and there's a more coarse side than the other side. And if you want to be real scientific about that, that's fine. Then just do that and be aware of that. Try and keep your glue off of your pumpkin, your corn husk. When I get it on there, I roll it off. And as you can see, this one was more coarse than this. I'll show you an example of what I mean. This side is a lot more coarse than this side. You can really see the difference. And usually the coarse side will absorb the color a lot more than the non-coarse side. So if you want all the brightness, then do it that way. I kind of like mine kind of mixed up. I think it kind of looks more natural that way. But again, that's going to be your opinion. Now I want to show you this guy. He's paper thin. He's really thin. He's a lot different, and I probably won't use him as much on the basket. He's going to be more likely to tear, and when you glue him, he might not be quite as good when we're done there. So, and by doing this bottom this way, instead of going all the way around it to the very end, it takes up less time and you use less corn husk and it looks so much better. So that is another advantage to stopping there with the corn husk. But I love the corn husk baskets, and they're not that cheap to buy. So I thought, why can't we make our own? I also want to try it on some of the bigger, not the real big jack-o'-lanterns, but the kind I picked up from Kroger this year. I think these would be big enough. That's one thing you have to think about, is it's got to be small enough, or your corn husk have to be big enough that it can go all the way around. Now this one I'm going to do from the top to the bottom. And put my glue on. Make sure you overlap the one before it. And stop at that end. So I'm just going to keep on working all the way around the pumpkin. And when I'm going over the ridges, if I can tuck them in, I tuck them in. If I can't, I'm not going to worry about the ridges. You don't really see the ridges as much because they're getting covered up by the whole corn husk quite a bit. So just continue working all the way around that. And then we'll stop when we get over to finishing that up, and we'll start from there. Before I go and finish all that, I wanted to tell you to save your little tails, because your little tails we're going to use on the top of this lid here if you want to do the lid. And I love the lid. I think the lid makes the piece. So these little tails we're going to save up and do those up here. We're also going to do the same thing with our corn husk here. And we just had a discussion on why we thought one side was coarse and one side wasn't. And I'm sure it's one side grows out and one side grows in. And the paper thin ones have to be the ones closest to the ear of corn. It gets real thin there. At least that's our theory, and we're sticking to it. So I'm going to put that guy there. And like I said, if you wanted to just leave him brown, you didn't have to cover him up. That's fine. There's no right or wrong. But I wanted to make sure to show you your tails. And I'll throw a couple of those on real quick so you can go ahead and do those as well. I just really love the corn husk. There's something about it, whether it's nature or what it is. There's just something about the corn husk that I really like. If you weren't going to put something on the sides here, I'd probably say just leave that part painted and just put the corn husk at the top. Now, I'm going to cut these straighter here. And we're going to start at the outside edge, and I'm just going to put the glue on that part and lay those down. And I left some of these, and some of these I didn't. And if you even have a long enough piece and you want to, if it's thick enough, do it again. But make sure that part's all the way down there. But some of those longer pieces I left, and you can just cover them with your stem. But there starts to be quite a few of them, so I started cutting them off. But the same way as you do the pumpkin itself, you're just going to work your way all the way around the top of this until you complete the top. So I'm going to go ahead and get both of these done, and I'll meet you on the other side. Okay, I went all the way around, and I have come back to where we started, and I did find a better way to glue. The more I do, the better we get at these, so you'll probably find ways to do it too. I found, and this one I'm going to run down because I've got a wider space up here, if I just went ahead and put the glue down this side and just did it that way and then overlapped it And then if you needed to put glue, now this one's sitting on the ridge, so I need to glue this side. But some of them I didn't need to glue. I only needed to glue on the one side, and that worked out much easier than trying to glue it up and down like I was doing. And it probably keeps the glue off the pumpkin a little bit better too. So I'm going to go ahead and glue this guy down. Sometimes when they come over that ridge right there, they want to stick up, and you have to glue those down. So we're going to do one more, and that is just to finish him off. And I'm going to do from the bottom up on this one. And this one I am not going to glue that way, just because I'm going a little bit further over on there. But I really do think that gluing was faster and easier that way, just to do it on the one side. Okay, so we've gone all the way around and finished gluing any little corners that are sticking out. Rub your glue off and try to keep that as clean as possible. I've got my lid all ready to go here. I'm going to go ahead and finish decorating it, and then I'm going to add some things around the edges. But let's go ahead and, I've already dropped them. How many times do I drop in the videos? That will be the bonus question. Got to put some Easter eggs in these so you guys can find answers, and the people that are watching it. I tell you what, the first person that sends me an email at art@miriamjoy.com that found their little Easter egg, how many times has Miriam bend over in videos, I will send a pair of leaf earrings to. So email me at art@miriamjoy.com. I'll know if you're paying attention to the videos. Maybe we'll even do a couple pair of leaf earrings. This is our paper twist. I've done 2 6-inch pieces, and I can't tell you how many of these I have unwrapped this year. Your paper twist you can find at Hobby Lobby, or you can go online if they don't have it at your craft store. Just look up paper twist. I keep the natural color. I can paint it any color I want. And once I've got them out, I want a bottom side that's kind of even. Then I tear the top part down so that's at an angle. And I told you, once of these, I would leave a couple of those in. That's up to you if you want to do that or not. But I'm going to put this part where I would glue. And I should have had this bent. I'm going to bend this part about 1/2 inch out. I'm going to put that, walk that around my stem, and try and get the front part and the end part straight out if you can, so you can have the next part go right into that. So we'll get this bent. This stem is not in the middle of the pumpkin. It is way on one side, but that's okay. There's, pumpkins are like that. Put that guy in the middle. So line this guy up over here so he is straight with that. So you don't have one look like he's longer or fatter than the other. They look like they're one part. And we're going to end that guy right there. I didn't quite make it around with all of this. It's a little bit fatter. We'll see if I cover that up with a leaf. If I don't, then I will come back and add a little bit of an add on there. So make sure that's on nice and it's not too warm and movable still. And then we're going to go ahead and twist our stems, make them more vine-like, like they actually grow. Make them look like they didn't get cut off. they were just kind of falling off. And I always kind of bring them out to the side there. And I'm going to go ahead and put, I'm not going to put them on because I'm going to put my bottom part on first, but all I do is I put two leaves on top of that, glue the hot glue those right down, and when you hot glue them on, if you push them in the middle, then they'll more stand up and curve in, which I really, really like, and then I finish them off with some berries on top. So that's how we do the basic leaf. If you wanted to put some wire in and do the spiral curlicue, you can do that as well. But that's our basic lid. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about this guy and about how the basket and everything is with that. This is a candle holder. And this is a, see if it tells me how many inches it is. It doesn't tell me, but it's a small candle holder. And you could set that and glue that right there and be done. Okay? You can find the candle rings in the craft stores, probably at your different home stores and everything. And I tried to find one that wasn't too big. And you could just absolutely done. This would really be a simple way to do it. And it actually fits right down into this part here. But to me, then it kind of doesn't look like a basket. So I want it to look more like a basket. Now, I'm going to show you, this is one of the garlands, and it's not a leaf garland. It's, see if they tell us what kind it is. They don't really tell us. It's kind of a fall garland, and it's, you know, the kind that you can kind of spread out, and it's not like the leaf. And usually you find it in a roll. You don't find it hanging with the big garlands, all wrapped up in a roll. And I tried to soak some stems. I did some over on this one and bend them. And what happens is this lid is still slanted in and it doesn't give you the room going back. So I didn't really like that as well. What I actually liked was using these as a handle and just pretend that they're kind of a stem, because you can bend them to look like stems. And I just took them and I worked them back and forth and kind of made my own stem type of thing out of them. Now these ones that are going down, when you get to the basket, turn them the other direction. Have them go up so that that kind of fills that way. And just play with that, work with that, and make your own handle, because you can stick these down in, and the more you play with it, the more it'll look better. But they kind of can be pushed in, and I didn't even glue mine in on one of them, and then one of them I did. I just hot glued it to the sides. So whatever you decide, and you may like it better without the hot or the handle on it. That's totally up to you. On this one, I used pine cone petals, and I cut them the size of the rim, and then on the outside. On this one, I have some acorns without the tops, and I've been waiting for a project for them, and I think I'm going to use these to try and go around. Now the petals, I just took my wire cutters and I just cut them straight off. And on these, you probably should pick like which direction I've got them going, and I think I would like them pointed down, or maybe up. The up is kind of the small area, so I'm going to put these in here going up. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the couple of rows that I'm doing and why I'm doing, but this would go really fast. I love the look of the petals, but that takes quite a while to do. Now, on these, you have an area of your pumpkin that is fatter. So if you can get wider ones to do, to cover that with, then get some wider ones to do. But what other things do you have that you think would look good in here? How about the acorn lids? I think that would be really cute as well. There's different things that, and I just decided that I wasn't going to care kind of which direction these went. I was just going to start placing them in. So I've kind of got that going around. But you may have some natural stuff, some nature stuff. And I just think the more nature we can do it, the funner it is. Starting to go back smaller here. Now, on this one, I did the bottom layer, so I do want to try and see if I can get a layer to clean this top part up here as well. And on this one, I may want to put that top part more towards the top. And that's just going to kind of clean the edges up. But like I said, what do you have? What do you like? What do you think would be fun on the basket? Make sure you're putting enough glue. You don't want it to squish out, but you do want it to stay. So I think that's going to be cute. And I do have some acorn lids that I think would be cute all the way around too. And this one I might not put the handle back into. So there's a lot of fun things you can do with that. And the corn husk goes a long ways. I probably used 5 or 6 of the corn husk pieces. So you can be able to make tons if you want to. If you want to do a different color, base coat it first with that different color. And then use that color corn husk over the top of it. But just have fun with it. Play with it. I'd love to see what you come up with. You can always email me at art@miriamjoy.com. Let me know if you ever have any questions on the projects that we're working on. Thank you. God bless.